So I'd like to welcome everybody to our meeting today. And we had a little bit of a glitch this morning. I'm getting our captions to start, but here we are and we're all set to go. We'd like to welcome you to our last meeting of the year. And we will not be having a meeting on January 1st because obviously it's January 1st. So we won't be seeing anybody until February. I'd like to introduce myself. My name is Ann Thomas. I'm the president of the HLAA Diablo Valley chapter. And I'd also like to introduce my fellow board members and just have them say hello so that you'll know who they are. Zohair Chiba is our vice president.
Hello, welcome.
Jill McFadden is our secretary.
Good morning.
And Walt Bateman is our treasurer. So Walt, you're going to have to unmute yourself to say hi. Well, Walt is here. If you look later, you'll be able to see him and what happens when people talk, there's a circle, a colored box that goes around everybody's who's speaking's thumbnail. So before we get started, we'd like to go through our normal directions for viewing Zoom on a desktop. We know that there are some people who are by this time old pros and very skilled at this. And there are also people who are still coming on new. And we want to make sure that everybody becomes skilled and comfortable using Zoom because it's a wonderful benefit for us with hearing loss. We're able to view people closer and read lips, and we all can only talk one at a time. So the first thing and the most important thing for all of us is that we have access to closed captions. So if you're not familiar with how to do that, these next pieces that I'm going to be describing to you are at the bottom of your screen, and you're going to see a toolbar. And right now we have a live captioner and the captions should be streaming for you. If by some chance it's not, open up that CC window and the top option will be click on subtitles. You have two other settings that are available to you, and one is to adjust the size of the font. And the other is you can view a full transcript. And I don't know if you're like me, I'm assuming that many of you are. I frequently don't realize that I didn't understand a word or didn't understand something until the captions are already passed. So if I have the full transcript open, I can scroll back quickly to see what was said so that then I catch that and then I can come back to the meeting and the captions and keep going. The next thing we'd like everybody to do is to, in Q&A or whenever you want to talk, is to raise your hand. It makes it much easier to ensure that people are called in order of when they would like to speak. So what happens on our side is that we see a hand in the participants window and also shows up in your thumbnail. The participants window orders the manner in which you raised your hand. Oops. So at the bottom of your screen, you have all of your Zoom controls. So if you see the microphone all the way to the left, by clicking that, you can turn your audio on and off. And we've turned everyone's audio off until it's time for you to speak, so that we don't get feedback. Because what happens when the audio option is open, it hears the sound from everybody's space and it creates a warble and a distraction for our sound. You can also turn your video on and off. If something happens and what happened at one of the early Zoom meetings was somebody got undressed and didn't realize that they still had their video on. So everybody saw this person getting undressed. So if you're going to do something that you don't want people to see you, just remember to turn your video off. You also have a chat option. And we encourage everybody to chat with each other. We'd like to ask that you can ask questions. You can say hello to friends. Once again, click reactions to raise your hand, and you can turn your captions on and off. We'd also like to mention that you can move the caption window anywhere you would like on your screen. All you need to do is hold it down and move it out of the way. Usually we also ask that people rename themselves, because since we have Zoom now, we have people from all over the United States. I already saw today, I know that we have, Arlene is from New Jersey, Geneva Ralph is from Oregon, and that way it allows everybody else to see where people are coming from. This is maybe one of the most important things when we have presentations other than the captions. So you have an option. If you look in your upper right-hand corner, when you click on that item that says view, you can select speaker, gallery, or immersive is kind of like a matrix. So the two that are the most important for everybody are speaker and gallery. And I always turn mine to speaker so that I see what's on the screen below with Zohair. And the importance of this is that while the presenter's talking, I can adjust the thumbnail of the presenter and also the presentation. So see that red circle, there are lines in the middle there. When you click on that, you can drag the windows back and forth. I like to be able to see a large enough picture of the presenter to aid in lip reading for me. Someone else may have low vision and they really want to see what's on the slide. So maybe for a slide that's really important to them, they would make that slide bigger. This is something especially for me when I get nervous or excited. I tend to talk faster. So we'd like to remind everybody to speak a little slower than normal. It makes it easier for all of us, and it also makes it easier for the captioner. If by some chance you have an external microphone, if you didn't connect it for this meeting, we'd like to remind you to dig it up for future meetings, because it is the de rigueur gold standard for audio using Zoom. And so if you see today, in the past, Alan kept, my old microphone was dying. I have a new microphone now, and I have an adapter that takes any microphone that you might have and converts it to a USB microphone for use with your computer. If anybody's interested in that, let me know. I'll be happy to provide that. So it's my great pleasure now to introduce my colleague, friend, and fellow advocate from New Jersey. She's a well-renowned national advocate, HLAA leader, and author. Her Communication Tips from Arlene was originally published in what is now called the Hearing Life magazine in 2008. And for a long time, I wished there was some way we could have Arlene come and talk to us about the great tips on how to make our holiday experience easier for us or more positive. So Arlene, I'm turning it over to you. And so everybody knows I'm going to be advancing the slides today, and Arlene is just going to say next, and then I'll move to the next one. It's all yours, Arlene.
Thank you, Anne. And it's really, I just can't believe I'm here. This is like a dream come true. For all, if you can listen to me, I'm originally from New York, okay? And I don't sound California at all. Just I'm listening to myself. Just to tell you, I'm in New Jersey, about 5 miles due west from the George Washington Bridge. Right now, I can see Manhattan from my window. So welcome to my territory. I started off in New York, and a lot of advocacy is between New York and New Jersey. Now, I wanted to tell you how I came to be here today, how that article got to be written. And to understand that, you really have to know a little bit about me and my hearing history. Let me just first ask, am I speaking slow enough, clearly enough, microphone enough, just as a communications check? Okay, because I know that some people are reluctant to cut in and say no, and I've had that experience. Somebody came up to me at the very end of a presentation and said she wished she had sat. And this is what this is about. This is what HLAA is about. You have to know what your needs are, and you also have to know how to make those requests. So it's all part of this presentation. I am a late deafened adult. I started losing my hearing as a teenager, late teens. I got through college okay, but I got my first hearing aid at age 23, one hearing aid. I'm not a teenager anymore. This was back in 1972. So they only had people wear one hearing aid. They didn't do two hearing aids at that time. So as my hearing loss progressed slowly, I changed that hearing aid, one hearing aid in my right ear forever. So it took 25 years for me to go from normal hearing to profoundly deaf. And gee, am I lucky, because when I was at the profound level, the telephone relay service came into being. My friend actually said I was lucky because I could use the phone. Then I got even luckier. I found HLAA in 1991, and I learned through the exhibit halls in the conventions that there were cochlear implants, and I tracked those cochlear implants every year at those HLA conventions. In 1997, I got my first cochlear implant, and 2008, my second. So I went from normal hearing to deaf in 25 years and back, but first 10 years with one ear, so single-sided deafness, and then that broke. So I was totally deaf for a month, and then I went bilateral, so I got two. So I've been there and done that, okay? I know everything pretty much, but I was not content to just have it my story. When I started losing my hearing, I said, and it became apparent, this was going to be going on and on. If this is going to happen to me, then something good should come of it. So there's always some way to make some good come of it. So that's lesson number one. Before we even start, attitude. Because, you know, woe is me, I wish. Chuck it, okay? Because you can do many things with the hearing loss if you have a good attitude. It's not Pollyanna, and I'm gonna take you on this path. Now to the actual meat of this presentation today, communication tips from Arlene, seven tips to better communication during the holiday season. Okay, now just imagine that holiday season with your family and friends and group parties, maybe not so much this year with pandemic, but that big dining room table, the people close by, and you get overwhelmed. So I'm going to give you the quote that started this article that I wrote in 2008. The holiday season can be very stressful for someone with a hearing loss, with large family groups gathering, laughing, and conversing. It's easy for someone with a hearing loss to feel left out, isolated, bewildered, and sad. Now, just recently, I mentioned this to a committee I'm on that was formed when the pandemic started. It's called the New Jersey Disability Action Committee. All people with disabilities. I was the only one with a hearing loss. They sent out an email wishing everybody a wonderful holiday season. It's a great time of year. We love it. And not one of those people had a hearing loss. I sent them an article I wrote. Unreal. They had no idea that for people with hearing loss, the holidays, it's not really the wonderful thing that they were looking forward to. And let me tell you, had all disabilities in this group, paraplegic, and I mean, you just, every sort of thing, wheelchairs, just everything. But hearing loss, they thought everybody just loved the holidays. And I said, no, not quite. So let's begin on how do we tackle these holidays. Okay, the first thing I told you was power of positive thinking, and not in a Pollyanna way. Just realizing, being eyes wide open, that this holiday season and the social events you are going to be involved in are difficult for every person with hearing loss. Ones from mild to profound, everybody with a hearing loss is affected by these types of festivities. They're hard for everybody. So it's not just you, and it's not something you're doing wrong, your audiologist did wrong. Everybody is impacted this. So once you realize you're not alone in that boat, I think that gives you some perspective on what you're dealing with. Okay, and the second point I want to tell you is be kind to yourself. You can say, gee, I wish I did this, or I wish I weren't here, and oh, I wish I didn't have this hearing loss, and all sorts of things. Just, no, put those negative thoughts out of your head. Think of what you can do, your positive effects that you can do, and not on the negatives that you can't do. All right, and I'm going to take you through all things that you can do without even me knowing what your level of hearing loss is or what you use, hearing aids, cochlear implants. Everybody can do something, okay? And from that words of wisdom, think that the glass is half full and not half empty. Next slide, please, Anne. Thank you. Okay, what's the easiest thing to do when you're somebody with a hearing loss? The easiest thing to do is talk with somebody one-on-one, face-to-face. That is our easiest way to have a conversation in whatever situation we find ourselves in. So you're at a family gathering and the living room is really crowded. The noise level is really crowded. So you go back to this single word of advice, one-on-one, one-on-one. How can we make this one-on-one? Well, maybe you find a friend or a relative you love to speak to and seek them out, but don't stand in the middle of the living room. Bring them to a quiet location. Maybe there are little children, grandchildren or whatever you haven't seen in a while, take one and also bring it to another room, a quiet room. Now, what I'm describing is an assertiveness, and you really have to like want to do it. If you're in a woe is me state, you're not going to do this. So get out of that woe is me state. You're going to say, this is what I can do. This is playing to my strengths. Okay. It's really sports 101. I just thought of that. Okay, what else could you do? Mosey into the kitchen. The kitchen is generally a quieter place, and you may even find some nibbles. That's good, you know, like Pavlov, feed yourself. Okay, kitchen is good, nibble. You might find you're good at cutting up carrots or something. Just find something that is positive that you could do, and maybe not think about conversation. So those were some ideas, and I'm sure you'd come up with your own, depending on your situation. Thinking positive, my hearing is not great in this noisy environment. Let me try to do something positive. Okay, thank you, Anne. Next slide, please. Now we get to the heavy stuff, okay? Because it doesn't really say so on this slide, but now we are approaching the dining room, okay, with all those chairs. And you are going to have to strategize in that dining room, because where you sit, who you sit next to, the location is going to impact how you survive this dinner. Okay, see, it says be pleasant and polite, but assertive. All right, you are going to be assertive. Now, I know from long experience that even though people with normal hearing can be gracious and want to help, it really can depend on how you do the ask, because they can become not so gracious and wonderful and lose patience. So you are going to play them, all right? I, you know, I'm saying things that are coming from the last 10 years where I have nuanced this information. Okay, the first thing you're gonna look at, where should I sit? Who should I sit next to? Which part of the table should I sit next to? Well, now you have to figure out what's your situation. I know people that have single-sided deafness, okay? If their right ear is deaf, they better not sit on the all the way left on the table. They are gonna have to sit where their ear can hear the most people. Same deal if we have one hearing aid or a better ear, put yourself where most of the people are on the side you're gonna hear the most. You know, it's not rocket science, but it requires thoughtfulness. And, you know, maybe somebody is sitting in the seat that you feel is your best location. You can be assertive and say, this really would be the best seat for me to use. Okay, you can do that. Smile. You want to have everybody happy. Just keep your wits about you and calm. Half full, not half empty. All right. You may know the people there. Some people have voices that you hear better than others. Some people have beards, mustaches. All right. You know, perhaps from experience, who you're best suited to hear. So position yourself to sit next to that person or between two people. That's location. Now, there are also concerns about where physical concerns. So if there's a window in the room, this is usually talked about in HLAA meetings, that you should position yourself facing the window, because the glare from the window can impact your ability to see people's faces. Also, if there's a TV on or music playing and, like, you know, football games, just ask the host politely. I don't think you should do this yourself. Don't turn it off yourself, but ask the host to turn off the sound. They're gonna say, oh, we'll lower the sound. I had this happen Thanksgiving. My son was gonna lower the sound. I said, no, off. And, you know, people with normal hearing, they don't really quite get it. No, off. And again, smile, this is what I need. It's gonna make me function better. So this may be things that you do or just do automatically, but knowing that you're doing it can give you a sense of empowerment that you are in control of your situation. Okay, now I mentioned that hearing people they have their own little quirks as far as dealing with people with hearing loss. Keep smiling. If you are angry or impatient, or why don't you understand? No, believe me, they will turn on you. It doesn't make sense. But just smile and gracious, even though internally you want to say, come on, get with this. No, just calm and smile. And why am I telling you this? because I've experienced it, that if I lost patience with a hearing person, they would turn on me, and all hearing people would turn on me. I only did this once, so don't get worried about it. But this is important to do. Half full, not half empty, and assertive with a pleasant look on your face. It sounds a little weird, but I'm telling you, it impacts the way people treat you. And that's the point of this. Next slide, please, Anne. Thank you. All right, now you're sitting at the table and you have a choice. You don't really necessarily have to make conversation, although it seems like a nice thing to do. You know, so if there's a hearing person on either side of you and you decide you just really don't want to deal with it, you know, I know my daughter would say, can't you talk? All right, so you can try. You can try if you've been hesitant because you're not sure if you're going to hear it. Okay, but give it a try. So if you're sitting next to somebody you chose, then if you start the conversation, then you know what everybody is talking about. If you wait for them to start the conversation now, what are they talking about? How many? And the whole vocabulary set, you are at a disadvantage now. So, okay, the advice is start the conversation. But I know, and you know, that many people with hearing loss can be motor mouths. They could talk like I am forever on any topic, because if they talk, they do not have to listen. Do not be that person in this social situation, okay? So pick a topic, anything that you would like to discuss, and you can ask a question, and it doesn't even matter what the answer is. You know what the question is. And I'm saying all this, you may think it's like, that's not real. This is real. It allows you to socialize on a level that you can handle. Now it's up to you, because you're hearing and whatever, and we'll get to some assistive devices. You may be able to handle more normal type things, but this is in a kind of worst case scenario. Okay, now, if you don't hear something, and this is just conventional wisdom, HLAA, don't just say what. Hearing people really respond poorly to what, because they don't know which what, all right? Was it the last hour they were talking or the last word they said? What gets them nowhere? So if you can supply any information at all that can give them a clue as to what you missed, do that. Anything. You could tell them, I heard you say the word sunshine. What were you talking about? And now they can grab onto that. But if you just say what? And as you are listening to me, I hope you're catching that you are creating an environment that is friendly to your hearing loss. You are managing the situation, but you're also making it easier for the people around you to deal with your hearing loss without blatantly, you know, saying, speak a little closer, this, you could do that too, but you're tilting the odds to make this pleasant for everyone. Half full. Can we advance the slide, please? Thank you. All right, this is the one that this is my favorite worst of all the topics, and I'll tell you in a second. Have you ever been in a room where somebody told a joke or something funny and everybody is laughing because it is so funny except you? You have no idea what was so funny. Okay, now, would you like to know why this happens? And I told you, I've been dealing with hearing loss for 50 years. I have rarely gotten a punchline on a joke. And that's with state-of-the-art cochlear implants, all the technology and all the techniques. The punchline is funny because it's not what people are expecting, okay? And any lip reading and comprehension that you're dealing with that is not 100% hearing, you know, context and expectations, by definition, the punchline is not going to be anything that you were expecting. So you're going to miss it. All right. And so your blood pressure starts to rise, that you're the only one in that room that is not laughing. And what do you do? All right. You could say, it's not important. But in your heart of hearts, everybody's laughing. Wouldn't you really want to know what was funny? So you have a couple of options, good ones. If you are next to that person that you're comfortable sitting with, ask them what was so funny. And, you know, if it's one-on-one, you could ask for repeats or whatever. Now, whatever works, that you will get that joke. However, sometimes there are more funny stuff coming along and the hearing person says, wait. So, you know, you can be a little bit savvy and say, remember that joke and tell me later. Okay. So now you've solved that. You're at peace with that thing you didn't hear. And you have a plan to be happy afterwards. All right. And that could work. Now, if you really had a couple of drinks and you want to be a little assertive, you could stop the whole table, depending on, you know, if you're with a whole bunch of college buddies, fraternity brothers. Wait, I can't hear that. I didn't hear that. Stop and tell me the whole joke again so I can. I'm just mentioning this option because you'll know what's appropriate. In some ways, that will be horribly inappropriate. But you never know, you could like laugh at it all. So that's jokes. I think we'll go to the next slide, thank you. Okay, you've survived the dinner table, got it? Now, there are strategies for after, because there's more socializing after. It's very similar to when you first walked in. Now, I thought about this and I had these strategies going back into the kitchen, and there's lots in that kitchen where you can do things that don't even require talking or people. It's not so noisy, there's no TV. So you could think of a few things, and I'm thinking if you want to just face a wall and putter with things, you'll be fine. It depends on your state of mind to do that. The other option now I'm considering is that you don't always have to be doing something. You don't always have to be conversing. You don't always have to be with people. You can take a time out. You can just go somewhere quiet. And I would say you can snoop around just what works for you, but not that, oh, I've had it with my hearing and this is terrible. No, I'm up to this part where I've used all my strategies and it's fine for me to take a break. I do not have to hear everything like every hearing person thinks they should, you know, and I've had people say, you should have asked me what we were talking about when they realized that I didn't. Well, I chose not to, because I had it. It was up to here. So that's an option too. You can just chill out a little bit. So it really depends. You can go back to all those strategies I mentioned in the beginning, pick out a child, pick out a friend, that too. But the point is, if you go in with a strategy and you're saying, I know this is difficult. I know I am like every other person with hearing loss. So knowing that means that my expectations to function like a hearing person are, that's not realistic. So I'm going to do what's good for me and Arlene and Anne and Bob and all the other people here, that this is how we're going to survive. Next slide, Anne. Okay, the issue of drinking or not drinking, it's really kind of funny thing, because if you're relaxed, some people report that they're better lip readers when they're drinking. And then some people report that they're worse lip readers when they're drinking. So this is a very individual choice about alcohol. I just keep thinking there are pros and cons of drinking itself that have nothing to do with hearing. And of course, never drink and drive. But I put the slide in here because drinking is a typical part of holiday festivities. And so you should be aware of how it impacts your hearing, either positive or negative. So this is a, see all the question marks? I don't know. I could give you that, what that means. It means this is something you should consider, but it's going to be different for every person. So consider it and make your own choice. So thank you for that one. And next, please. Okay, now I mentioned that there were assistive listening devices or assistive devices that are good for social events and other events too. And these definitely should be considered if you have not tried them or seen them or even known about them. Usually HLA people are pretty good about knowing about these devices, especially if you get the magazine. The tried and true oldest one is the pocket talker. And while you're thinking, we're thinking in terms of how are we going to function better with these devices, I'd like to give you a little perspective on the pocket talker. We know that there are older people who may not have hearing aids who hear, whose hearing is deteriorating, you know, in their 90s or more, and could benefit just from a simple pocket talker. If that's a handheld device with a microphone, and headphones or a way to interface with hearing aids. So somebody speaks into the microphone and it goes straight to somebody's ear. Very low tech. The interesting thing with pocket talkers back here in New Jersey, those pocket talkers were given to patients in our local hospital if they were discovered to have hearing loss. And the patients, when they used them as a patient in the hospital, did not want to give them back when they were discharged. So they took it upon themselves to actually buy a little cheaper version, but still worked, and send the patient home with the effectively a pocket talker. And I got a letter from, I was involved with this, hospital access. So I got a letter from a woman who got one of these, and she was at a holiday party and was able to hear her grandchildren for the first time. She would always just sit there. And that meant a lot. And a little too late for me. My grandmother could have used that. It was working better for her than the hearing aid she was given. So give that some thought, not just for yourself, but others in the family who might benefit from that. So the other devices that are listed here are similar in nature, effectively getting a microphone close to the mouth of the person speaking. I have the Roger Select, which is a wireless, it's about a silver dollar sized electronic thing that with lights and everything, has six microphones. If you put it in the center of a table, it will pick up the voices of people and send it to your hearing aid or cochlear implant. I have not tried it yet, but it can be used to pick up a specific voice as well. So I leave it to the HLA chapters with the resources of the magazine and getting word out about these assistive devices. In New Jersey, we have some from the state assistive device demonstration centers. so people can make an appointment. I don't think now with the pandemic, but where they can actually try things out. So those are the microphone-based devices. There are apps that caption, and those have become very popular now with the pandemic and masks. You know about that. And so it's taking speech, converting it to text on your phone. So live transcribe, which is for Android phones, but Otter and Ava do automatic speech recognition and take voice to captioning. So with ambient noise, that might affect the clarity of the text it's generating. So eyes wide open. Listed are personal amplifiers, which I personally am not familiar with. So I'll leave it to Anne for another meeting to describe all that. And with that, I would tell you that I like to take questions now, but before I do, I'd like to advance to the next slide and tell you a little bit more about me. Okay, that's me a little while ago. And the picture is the cover of my book, Listening Closely, A Journey to Bilateral Hearing. I mentioned that was my second book. It came out in 2010. And it was the journey from the entire journey of my listening hearing experience from normal hearing to hearing aid, to cochlear implant, to device failure, to bilateral. And the thing is that people have told me that, including many, many audiologists, that this really opened their eyes to what hearing loss was about, the importance of two ears, the benefits of being bilateral, all sorts of things. And that's why I wanted to mention it to you now, because as I open the group up to questions, I will take questions on the entire spectrum of hearing loss. If you have things that might relate to cochlear implants, it's all related. So there's no question that's outside the box. So I'll just turn it over to Anne to run this Q&A. And I hope that this has been helpful to you. My message to you all is that don't dread going to those social engagements. Just bring your toolbox with you and your attitude, and that the glass is half full if you see it as half full, and that's half the battle. If I sound Pollyanna-ish, it's because I learned that you can't train yourself to be positive. And that's an important lesson, which I hope you've learned today. So thank you.
Arlene, that was just wonderful. I'm sure that we're going to have lots of people with questions, especially since our chapter more and more is becoming a cochlear implant chapter. For those of you who are here today who don't know, I've gotten, actually my anniversary for my first implant is the 10th. And within 6 months, I had two implants and my life is absolutely over the top, completely, dramatically altered in a positive way. So Jill, you run the Q&A. So we're open for questions, everybody. And don't forget, raise your hand. You mean Arlene did such a good job? Nobody has a question. Nobody has a thought. So Arlene, you know what? See, that's what happens when you do such a good job.
Geneva is raising her hand.
Well, and if I may, thank you. This was, I don't have hearing loss, but I'd love to translate back everything that folks who are experiencing this do to my friends with hearing, you know, more normal hearing. So I always say, I don't have hearing loss yet. I want to learn everything I can as we go forward with this. A couple of questions. One's personal. You sounds like you got one of the very earliest cochlear implants. Can you talk a little bit about technology? Have you upgraded that? I'm curious how that's changed for you, how you've done new mapping, new learning. I mean, Anne, I think your progress with the new CIs is just amazing from what I'm hearing from people. I'm curious about holiday music. My business is putting on live concerts and live performances and having pre-concert dinners where I put up a portable hearing loop at all of the tables where I at least know somebody has hearing loss so that everybody, you don't have to have something that's Bluetooth compatible or, you know, a Roger Select pin or something like that. I think there's so much more. And I do think we in the hearing community really are trying to do our half of the conversation. But I love some of the tips that you've done, like put the captions on the football game. Who needs to hear those guys?
Oh, you asked a lot of questions and I have a lot of
answers.
No, that's great. Okay, my blog, when I started writing a blog, was Ask Arlene. Okay, that was the name of the blog. My team at the New Jersey Walk for Hearing for the past 14 years has been Ask Arlene. Okay, and I will wear a cap, Ask Arlene. Okay, I started tracking cochlear implants in 1991. Okay, they started implanting them in 1989. There was one company that was implanting in 1991, and a second company came on was approved in 1994, 95. Okay, personally, I had to wait until 1997. I had some family issues that you can't do a cochlear implant with other stuff going on. So 1997 was when I did my due diligence. I had to have a cochlear implant at that point. And the second company that had come on, their capabilities as compared to the other company at that point in time was significant. So when I was activated, I put out an email. Okay, Facebook wasn't really there yet. I put out an email because there were audiologists who were very interested in my experience because I could articulate what was going on. And also they were implanting children, so the kids couldn't report. So day one, I put out an email. Day two, an email. And then the chief audiologist at a local, I don't know if you know, the New York League for the Hard of Hearing. It's a very well-known hearing center in New York. They're now called the Center for Hearing and Communication. I'm on the board there. I've been on the board for a lot of years. Their chief audiologist, Moore. They wrote me more. They wanted me to write more. So I was keeping an email journal for all these people, including audiologists, back in 1997, that first year. And they wanted that turned into a book. I said it should be a whole year. And so after a year, that was the first book. And it showed what a cochlear implant could do. At that point in time, it was higher speed stimulation that made that differ from the original company. And I was able to do music right away and also on the phone within a week. So that was high speed. That internal failed after 11 years, okay? And the irony of this, and you would appreciate it, it's your question. People who were my colleagues with cochlear implants said, lucky. They said, lucky, because I could get the internal from 1997 replaced with the new internal 2008. And it was faster speed, could do more, had greater capability, and they built in space for new improvements. Okay, so at that point in time, there were people fighting for Medicare and insurance companies to cover two implants, because in 2007, that's when they first started covering two implants. So I didn't even have to fight, 2008 too. And the second book was the difference between one and two. And it's enormous for things that were not apparent by audiologists, not apparent to people with normal hearing. You really had to walk the walk. So there was a third company that is now, you know, they're all competitors. And we benefit because they're all competing with each other to get the latest and the greatest. So yes, I have Bluetooth now. It is the weirdest experience, answering a phone by tapping your ear and talking to nobody. I mean, I just tell everybody, hello, I'm a bot. You know, it's like, it's like crazy. But what's significant, and I'm talking to all you guys, I have spanned 1972 when there was no way you could wish for something that would allow you to hear again. You just wouldn't let yourself go there. It was impossible. Okay, biblically impossible, allow the deaf to hear. Now, and then lo and behold, 30 years later, it's, you know, FDA approved. So it's a wild ride, and I felt obligated to document it. So that's what's significant in those books as well. And the audiologists would review all of my entries as I wrote them. I just wanted to make sure I was making sense. And their comment was always the same, more, more. They wanted more because they can do what's clinically, they can test and adjust, but they want to know what it's like and what the significance is. And so the presentation I just gave, there are ways, programs on your processor to tilt the odds that you will not have to hear all that background noise and focus on one person. And that's very individual to the device and to the person who's using it. So you asked a very good question, and that's, I hope that's helpful to you. The fact that you're here as a hearing person, to me, is enormous. I mean, just that you have that interest in caring for other people with hearing loss. I really thank you for that. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, and of course, like any good researcher and writer, you opened another bunch of them. Can you tell me when the last update on your book was, or have you, because 2010 now is a while ago.
Well, you know, I've thought about that. The publisher on that book, he wanted to retire it, you know, and I said, you can't do that because the information is still current. In other words, the differences in the processors now are Bluetooth. It's not changing what I wrote. So what they did, I mean, I'll tell you first, what they did do was make an ebook, okay? And they turned it into an ebook. And so that can be available with nobody storing, you know, stock. They don't have to take up warehouse space, and it's always available. And that was the compromise. But I will tell you that the company that made my processors, they initially purchased a large number to distribute among their patients. So there are a lot of copies out there. So if you look at Amazon or everything, there are always copies that are available, new, used, whatever. The thing that I learned was I did not make a fortune on this book with royalties, but I do know that I was contacted by some audiologists who told me they would lend the book out to their clients, their patients. And one audiologist just recently, you know, the book was published 2010, just recently, like, you know, within the past year, she said, Arlene, you will have no idea. You have no idea how many people you've helped with this book. So I don't know what that means with numbers, but writing a book is not an easy thing to do, but I was, I felt I had to do this because I was in a very unique position to know what was before, compare, contrast. And, you know, I just welcome everybody to read it. It's not just about cochlear implants. It's really about what hearing does to your life, what one ear does to, and even with your loved ones, turning around to your name, all of these things, turning to sounds of danger, crazy things you don't think about that are built in. Would you believe that before that second ear was turned on, my brain could not do that for me? It had to know there was a second one there. That second one was dormant for like 40 years and you turned it on and immediately I turned to danger sounds. That's crazy, okay? I'm like, whoa, I really put the parts in. I just couldn't use that. So I just mentioned that there's a lot in that book. There are no wasted words. Let's just say that. I thank you again for your question.
I'd like everybody to know that Genevra is with the Shedd Institute in Eugene, and they have won the HLAA Get in the Hearing Loop Award. Was that 2018?
Let's see. It was when we were all excited to get to Orlando New Orleans. So whatever year. I'm still going to collect on that, Anne. We'll just do a party in New Orleans together.
Well, let me tell you, I would love to party with you in New Jersey. All right, this is relevant. I had TQLs on hearing aids since 1970, okay? But in New Jersey, there aren't very many looped facilities, so I really didn't get a chance. We do always put a temporary loop, high quality, and it worked extremely well. I always made sure to have my T-coil program available so I could try anything. Right before the pandemic, I went to a disability conference in Washington, D.C., and it was in the Rayburn Building. They were providing me with captioning. They sat me up front. There was panelists with microphones. There was an ear logo sign outside, but no T. I didn't want to bother with anything. So I sat there with the captions and then this little light bulb went off in my head. Let me put on my T coil. Holy moly. All of a sudden, all the speakers that were talking were straight into my head like you cannot believe. I mean, unbelievable, crystal clear. The thing with cochlear implants is from the microphone to the T coil, it doesn't turn back into sound. It goes straight to your brain. Okay, with a hearing aid, it turns to sound, and then you have your ear. With a cochlear implant, it does the signal to signals, so there's nothing degenerates. And my brain knew it. And then right around the same time, Temple Emmanuel in Manhattan was having a huge Holocaust commemoration program. And I knew that sanctuary was looped. It's my friend as an advocate. Turned on my T-coil, totally blown away because there was Yitzhak Perlman there, there was Tova Felcher, there was Joel Gray, there was unreal. And I was hearing better than anybody there because they were hearing from loudspeakers, all right? But I was hearing from the microphone to my TQL. So what happened next? HLAA advocate, we advocated for legislation, and that's what we're doing now. Legislation to require induction loops in places of public accommodation and countertops in new construction and renovations. And so now I'm a lobbyist, but I'm talking to you because we're all connected. So if we could discuss how we can help each other, I would be very much interested in that.
I think that's absolutely fantastic. And every state should learn from what somebody like you is able to do. And Arlene, Albuquerque just had Carolyn Adamski, A-D-A-M-S-K-I, on last month. She's the gal that wrote for Science Magazine about being a researcher, about Zoom. And she didn't know really anything about loops. She's got one hearing aid, one CI, but she's a very powerful speaker. It's the first time she really talked about this. But I think there's a whole issue about what do we do for folks, not only in higher ed, and UVA just came out with a terrific policy statement that I've asked our university here to adopt, but how do you travel to seminars, to conferences, to places in hotels that aren't looped, that aren't the Rayburn Building, and how do you deal with breakout rooms and tabling and that sort of thing? So I think it's a combination of legislation, but also proactive understanding what all those tools are, Arlene, that you brought to the table. Anyway, another topic, sorry, but Adamski was a fabulous speaker, Anne.
Thanks, Geneva. And I just want everybody to know, I mean, all of you who are members of the Diablo Valley chapter know that I wear many, many hats in our HLAA family. And one of the hats that I wear is I'm on the Get in the Hearing Loop Committee, which is a program of HLAA. And I'm just finishing up the end of what turns out to probably be a four plus year project of, it's a Get in the Hearing Loop handbook that's 100 plus pages. And there's a supplemental how-to step-by-step advocacy document. And the hope is that by having these two pieces of literature information, it's going to be everything that everybody needs to have to be able to go forth and to advocate. So all of the tools that everybody needs, the Get in the Hearing Loop toolkit is on the HLAA website. It's been there since I think 2019 now, but having everything all together, including all of the laws, examples of publicity pieces, everything that you could want. And then the supplement, originally we were thinking we were going to put the advocacy piece as part of the handbook. And as the handbook got so big, you know, all of a sudden it seemed really obvious that there needed to be a supplemental information tool. And the advocacy step-by-step, we're now approaching 30 pages. So recently when I was going through with some other, with Sherry Parazzoli, when we're working on this, if you have any problems planning anything in your life, this advocacy guide will be a huge help for you because it's step-by-step planning and what kinds of things you need to think about. And hopefully it's in lay terms. So we'll be able to get your feedback about how well we did. And I'm hoping it's going to be available the beginning of March. So, or mid-March, there's a International Federation of Hard of Hearing People conference in Budapest. And Juliet Sterkins and our executive director, Barbara Kelly, are both co-presenting on hearing loops. And we're hoping to be able to have this finished, run, printed, to be able to take so it can become the foremost informational pieces on hearing loops in the world. So I just want everybody to know that that's something that's coming. And Arlene, something that you might not know, because we're only talking about three manufacturers of implants now. We now have a fourth. So it was available in Europe for a couple of years. Now Oticon has their implant, which was approved by the FDA, I think maybe in August or something like that. So there are now four. And Geneva, always love seeing you. Thank you for joining us, asking wonderful questions.
Well, great group. Your advocacy is extraordinary. And I love Zoom for this because I love being able to see you all and learn from you.
Just wanted to mention that the legislation actually was to not just do what the legislation does, but to draw attention to induction loops. So what we discovered was it was a two-pronged process because people don't know what we're calling hearing loops. Doesn't matter what you call them, they won't know what it is. So we discovered you had to educate first and then advocate for the legislation. So what ends up happening is you discover that there are legislators who have hearing aids, right? And or one degree of separation thereof. And also that you tell them that the ADA is ignored, okay? That this is our legislation is just saying this is our preferred method of the assistive accommodation that's required by the ADA, and it's generally ignored. And you tell them that, and our message, it's not a fast process, but we're on a very steep learning curve because I never did this before, but we have made great progress. And also getting people involved that were not hearing loss advocates, the entire spectrum of people with disabilities. We have a committee now that covers everything. And we are one for all and one for one. So that spread the number of people who could write letters or could support the effort. So I mentioned that to you because it really was significant. All these years, we were just hearing loss, not working with the others. And now we are because of the pandemic. And that's how we ended up with legislation. These people did legislation. They've always done legislation. We never did. So I said sheepishly, do you think that? They said, yeah, and they pointed the way. That's how it happened.
Anne, may I say one more thing? Because Arlene touched on the education piece. Arlene, we put in a hearing loop in a beautiful concert hall, said, everybody come and, turn on your telecoil, come and listen. And everybody said, what? Including everybody with hearing aids. That didn't happen when we put an elevator in. Nobody asked me what it was for, how to use it. So then we turned before that. We were smart enough to know that we needed to work with the hearing specialists in town, but they still sometimes will say, well, nothing's looped. So it's such a battle, and it really takes everybody with hearing loss to say, yes, I want my Bluetooth and I want my telecoil.
Exactly.
But one of the pieces in the Get in the Hearing Loop toolkit that was created to address the issue that Geneva just mentioned is this. Oh, and I have something else up on my desktop here I was going to show you. So it's this Hear card. So and this is an older version. We have updated the language so that it includes an option for people to know that they could request a receiver and a headset. So this explains what a hearing loop is, and this shows you how to use it. And there's another document that goes with this that's take to your audiologist a card. So lots of the audiologists don't know how to program telecoils. So this is for your audiologist and hearing aid provider, telling them how to program the telecoil and then leaving the space on here to write directions for the patient. I also just wanted to remind everybody here about the work that we've actually done in everybody. I kept telling everybody, ask for communication access. And everybody kept saying, well, I don't know what to ask for. I don't know what to do. And as a result of that, from listening to all of our members and all of the people who we encountered at outreach events, and we generally in the past held at least, participated in five a year, we have a brochure for Ask for Communication Access. And then people kept saying, in California, all of the cities have parks and recreation departments that run all of the educational components from the city. And so they're entitled to under the ADA, and they weren't providing access for us. And so it came out, well, who do we ask? And so the person who you needed to ask was the ADA mandated coordinator for the city. And then when we started looking around, we realized lots of cities didn't have them, and how could we make it easy for everybody to find out who that is? And as a result of that, and thank you very much to my colleague, friend, I don't know how to say how wonderful he is, Alan Katsura. We, for now a couple months now, have, and it was a long-term effort, we have hearing access on our website. You click on ADA coordinators. Sometimes when you share a window, Zoom doesn't work very well. And what started out to be the ADA coordinators for our county, I thought, well, after we got it set up and everything, let's see if we can do all of California. And theoretically, this could be for everywhere in the country. And then you have to do the work. So it's a living document. And obviously maintaining this kind of information is daunting. So that's why we rely on all of you. If you live in one of these cities and you see here, here's the plus, you press on the plus, and you have a drop-down window with all of the information you need. The phone number's even hot. If you see information here that's no longer accurate, you need to let us know so we can update it. I'm really super, super proud of this. It was over 5 years of work. We also have, there's a project that you all don't know about. We've been working with Google, and sometime soon, I hope very soon, hearing loops are going to be on Google Maps. And that's just because of us.
Oh, I heard about that. Yes.
So what we have for our location, and to make it easy, and it's also different than the map, I mean, you have the map, but that's with you. But let's say you're at home and you want to think about something. The Google Maps isn't going to give you a full list. So Alan and I thought that lists are easier, and you can search by city. These are the known hearing loops that we have in California that have been vetted. There are some loops that are not on this list because we haven't been able to confirm that they exist. So both of these things are available to everybody. We want to make sure that everybody spreads the word, and please go in and check to make sure that the information we have is correct. Because basically on this, it's been Alan and me, right? So we can use everybody's help. Does anybody have any more questions, comments, ideas, desires for programs? So we're really going to ask for your help next year. We need a program committee. We need a handful of people to really sit down and plan out what kinds of things that we want people to know about. And Susan Beck, I just saw you raised your hand. Can you please unmute yourself?
I just have a comment. The one big takeaway I got from Arlene's talk was about asking what. It's so frustrating when I say what and people go through the whole spiel and I only missed one word and it's my fault because I didn't say specifically what I wanted to know. And of course, then when they're repeating it, you miss half of what they repeat anyway. So thank you. I will try to remember to be specific when I say what. And that was really good information for me.
Walt, unmute yourself.
I just want to make a humorous comment to Arlene. I'm originally from New York, and I haven't lived there for umpteen centuries. But anyway, I was taking a walk, and I met two men, and we stopped to talk. And within my speaking two or three sentences, he said, "You must be from New York." And I haven't been there in over 60 years, so you don't lose your accent.
That's cool. The crazy thing is, my children grew up in New Jersey and they don't sound like me.
So. Oh, interesting.
Yeah, it's very funny.
We have a few more announcements and things. First of all, historically, when we meet in person, and I actually don't know when this is going to happen. I think it's really ludicrous for us to think about meeting in person with face masks, because none of us can understand each other even easily with clear ones. So I don't know when that's going to happen. So here's our, Bob makes handmade muffins for all of our meetings. And this is an extension, a continuation of what we have in person. So we can sort of have the feeling of love that he extends to all of us. We have some announcements. First of all, UCSF, the Department of Otolaryngology, is looking for people to participate in a mapping music perception study for anybody who's interested in a Med-L cochlear implant. And I'm in the process of putting together a newsletter for us for December that hopefully will have all of these pieces in it. It's just not completed to send to all of you. Stanford is also looking for recruiting for patients for a research study for cochlear implants. They are going to pay a $50 gift card to everybody in appreciation of their time. And they're looking for screeners, and they have a screener that you take online when you click this, and they're evaluating who to participate in their study. This is something so important for all of us. I just want to stand up and yell from the rooftops. We've come halfway, and now the biggest part is in front of us. So the House of Representatives passed, including hearing aid coverage for Medicare. So now it's in the Senate, and of course it's a Republican-controlled Senate. I'm keeping my fingers crossed that there could be enough of them with hearing loss that it may compel them to cross over and vote for this hearing aid coverage. We've all wanted this and complained and bitched and moaned about not having this. And I want to say this again, if you do not take the time to go to the HLA website, put in the search engine Medicare, and then what comes up is easy directions, and now you only have to contact the Senate. You have nobody but yourself to blame. It's not just me. It's not Arlene. It's not just people who generally through life take action. This is your chance to stand up for yourself and for everybody else with hearing loss. So give yourself a Christmas present and do this. We also like to remind everybody that hearing loss is a disability covered under the ADA. You need to ask for communication access. It's 31 years old this year, and we haven't gotten a lot of traction. I know some of the work that I have done has been very valuable. I know that because of me, all of the libraries in Contra Costa County have a hearing loop.
Can you come to New Jersey too, please?
Oh, I'll tell you how I did that, Arlene. I contacted them to see if, so I love to read. So when I started thinking about where am I having problems with, I couldn't understand at the library when I would go to check out a book. So I thought, oh, I'm going to start with something that has meaning and value for me. And it turned out they were just in the process of creating a disability access committee for the library. And the timing for that was, thank goodness I asked, because they were getting ready to buy Pocket Talkers. And that would not have worked. So now when you go to our libraries, sometimes the people don't necessarily who are there know how to use them. It's this ongoing piece all the time. Because what happens is the person who was there before somebody was trained, and then they left, they moved on, they did something else, and the person behind them doesn't get the information. So if nothing else, that's something you can do. And I've started using a different language around my hearing loss. And those of you who've been attending all of our monthly meetings have been aware of this change. And what it is I say that people with hearing loss live uncertain lives, because we never know when we're going to be able to hear and when we aren't. And if we want to be able to function the best we possibly can, we have to ask for those accommodations before we do activities to ensure that we can understand people. So right now, generally, as you all know, I'm doing outstandingly well, but I still live an uncertain life. I'm participating in these meetings with senior executives at UCSF. I had a meeting last week of 80 people from the hospital system, and I could understand half of the people, and I could understand them with no problems. But the other half of the people, if I hadn't asked for captions to ensure that we had captions for the meeting, I couldn't have understood them. So I know that sometimes for some of us, when we're doing pretty well, we feel guilty about asking for the accommodations that we really need. Because, you know, maybe we're downplaying it. Maybe we feel like we're putting somebody out. But each one of us has a unique and important gift to give. And if you can't understand what people are saying, you can't participate well. And if you can't participate well, you can't bring your gift of your being into the world. So where can you ask for accommodations? Everywhere on the chart in front of us. A slide in front of us. And a project that they've done in Colorado has been getting captions for movie theaters. And if a bunch of people wanted to get together for 2022, we could do that. But I can't do it alone. So I want to spread the seed, plant the seed. I want everybody to think about what else they can do to help themselves and all of us in 2022. So you know where we are. You know we're here to help you. We also have an assistive listening device demonstration library, and we are open to demonstrating how devices work to any of our members or anybody in the community. We even loan them out. The state also has a loan program. It's a little bit cumbersome to use because you have to know beforehand what you might want to borrow from them. And then they loan it to you, I think, for a month at a time or whatever. So I'd like to wish everybody a really warm, happy holiday to spend, whether it's with family or whether it's not with family, whether you're choosing to mask or unmask. And is there anything that anybody else has to say, any wishes that you'd like to express to any of the people on our meeting today? Just unmute yourself and say Merry Happy Holidays or Happy New Year to you, because we're not going to see each other till February.
Thanks for letting me jump in. Happy holidays, everybody.
Thank you for inviting me. I love spending time with HLA chapters. You're a great bunch. Thanks so much.